Hi everyone, welcome back to another question and answer video. I asked you guys on Facebook to send me some questions that you wanted answered, and I'm going to answer the ones that were the most popular, that had the most thumbs up. So let's get started. Okay, the first one is from Julia. She says, how do you come up with new techniques? For example, coloring with Copics on vellum or anything else that is basically new. Do you experiment? I'm always in awe of the creative ways you use stamps, markers, and ink pads. So I would probably say about half of the time, 50%, I'm responding to things that I've seen online where, you know, that could be someone has done a technique and I want to try it out. Or it could also be I see something and I try to figure out a way that I can make it work with the supplies I have. The other 50% of the time, it's just me experimenting, just like coming up with something. And most of the time, I'm like, wow, I think I discovered this new technique. And I text my friend Jennifer McGuire, and I'm like, isn't this awesome? She's like, oh, yeah, I did that last month on my blog. I'm like, oh, dope. Because she is the technique queen. So if you're looking for new techniques for anything, go to her blog, search for, you know, if you're looking for techniques for die cutting, go to her blog and search die cutting techniques, and lots of stuff will come up. She's really, really good about sharing techniques, so I would really recommend that. The next question is from Teresa. She says, loved your collaboration with Catherine Pooler. Are you going to do more of those videos? I hope so in the future. I'm not entirely sure what those will be. I don't have any plan currently, but it was really fun, and I think it'd be nice to do it again. Esther says, how do you store all your stamps so that you can find the images that you want for a project if it's been a while since you used that set, especially since you get to try so many from various companies? Gosh. The way my system works is I have a box next to my work area, my crafting desk over here, where I put all of the new stamp sets that are coming that, you know, I've just ordered and they just arrived. I like to put them all in one spot and they stay there until I've used them, or it's like past that kind of season for card making. For example, if I had like a couple Valentine's Day sets that I didn't get around to, if it's very specifically Valentine's Day and not just love, I might go ahead and stash those in with the rest of my stamps. And then the next time, because I do have some, for the most part, all of my stamps and dies are stored by manufacturer, by brand, and then alphabetized within that brand. However, for Valentine's and Christmas, I think those are the two, I have separate categories, and it's just all Christmas, all Valentine's. So I would just put those in there, and then next year when I'm ready to start Christmas cards or Valentine's cards, I'll go through that stash and kind of leaf through everything and see if there's something that I wanted to use the year previous and never had a chance. That's what happened with that leprechaun card that I did a few weeks ago for Color Wednesday. I had that stamp set, but I never got around to using it before St. Patrick's Day. So this year, I remember that I still had that, and I wanted to go back and grab that stamp set and make sure that I made a card with it. As far as like really, really old stamp sets, things like that, you have to make a conscious effort. Sometimes I'll be looking through all of my new stuff that's on my desk in that box that I mentioned, and I'm like, oh, nothing's really striking me at the moment. So then I'll just kind of leaf through all my stamp sets and even the old ones and see if something stands out. Sometimes I'll have a specific card topic in mind, like I want to make a birthday card or I want to make a sympathy card or something like that. So I will search through my stamp sets looking specifically for something that would work for that. And when I do that and I'm using a lot of different stamp sets, I like to really challenge myself to use like two or three different stamp sets. So maybe there'll be like a graphic bold stamp on one stamp set, and I'll use that to create a background, and then I'll find an image on another stamp set, and then I'll find a greeting on another stamp set. So it's just a way to really get yourself mixing different stamp sets creatively. So if you want to take that challenge, take that challenge and look through your old stamp sets and see if you can find three stamp sets that will all work together. Mary says, I need a surefire way to tie a bow with ribbon. I never seem to get it looking like anything other than a hot mess. I'm going to link up to a video in this top corner. It was one of my very first videos on YouTube. It's how to tie a knot. And then over on this side, I will link to how to tie a bow. I have two videos. They're older videos, but it's still the same technique and it should help you. Okay, so let's see, another one. Jaded Stephanie says, you are an inspiration to a lot of us card makers out there. Who inspires you to be crafty? Recently, well, there are a couple blogs that I love to go to. One is what her blog is called. My Paper Secret, I think. It's Christina Kowalsik. I think that's how you say her last name. She's fantastic. She's a great clean and simple stamper, and she always has a really creative and fun way, really unique way of looking at stamp sets and how to do really simple stamping but have it be really impactful. So I really love her stuff. And if you follow me on Pinterest, that's no secret because I pin a lot of her cards. The other one, I really love Laura Bassin. I love how she approaches her cards as well. And absolutely love Debbie Hughes. Those are three, probably three of my favorite card makers currently. They can almost do no wrong when they make a card. I love to follow their blogs. And ever since Google Reader went by the wayside, since they like stopped supporting Google Reader last summer, I really haven't been as big of a blog surfer as I was in the past. I look a lot on Pinterest, and then I have just a few blogs that I check out every single day. So, yeah, those three are probably ones that I would look at and get lots of inspiration. Okay, someone said they were asking about sending an easel card. Sally asked about sending an easel card, and Kathleen had a really good suggestion for that. I'm going to answer this question kind of in general. Like when you have an interactive card that you send in the mail to someone, so you are not there to show them how it works, I think the answer that Kathleen had is a great example. If you can find some instructions online or even just a picture of, you could take a picture of how it should be set up and include that in the card and with a little note that says, you know, this is an easel card, you can prop it up like this. I think that's a great way to let them know that that's what they can do with the card. Mayra asks, other than Copic markers, what are other good brands to use? As you know, Copics may be kind of pricey for some of us. I can't recommend ones that I haven't used, but I do know a lot of people like Spectrum Noir. They really like those markers. I have not used them personally myself, so I can't say if, you know, one or the other, if you're gonna like them or not. If you're looking for just basic markers for good techniques, I would go with Distress markers. They are considerably less in price compared to Copics, and you can do a ton with them. You can watercolor with them, you can color straight on the paper, not add any water. You can do backgrounds. You guys have seen me do this in a bunch of videos recently. You can use Distress markers on practically everything. So I would really recommend Distress markers just because there's so many different things you can do with them. Let's see. Alicia asks, how do you get your cutting mat on your desk to stay put? Mine wants to move around every time I'm working on it. Okay, so I have that non-slip shelf liner that you would normally put in your cabinets. I just cut it to the exact size of my grid mat and put that right under my grid mat so it doesn't move at all. And I love that because I always have my camera mounted in the same spot above my desk. So by not allowing that grid mat to ever move, I never have to reset up my shot for filming. I just put my card in my camera, turn it on, and it's ready to go. All right, I'm gonna do one more question, and it is, what ink brand would you recommend to buy as a starter set to have a good variety of colors for a variety of techniques? That's a good question. I would probably recommend the Distress Ink Mini Pads. They come in a pack of four, and I think there's three different packs. So you get a bunch of colors, and they're small. They're great for travel as well. Along with those Distress Inks, I would recommend that you get Versamark and VersaFine Onyx Black and possibly ColorBox Fluid Chalk Ink and Chestnut Roan. I think those are all really good inks, and you have your kind of basics covered with the black and brown, but then you also have your distress inks. Oh, and I would throw in one more. I would probably recommend either Stazon Jet Black or Archival Jet Black. Those are both waterproof inks that you can use with the distress inks when you add water to them. So that's probably essential if you're going to do distress inks as well. Okay, so those are all my questions for today. I hope to answer more questions in the future. I don't have a specific posting schedule for these question and answer videos. It's just whenever I feel like filming a video for you guys. So I hope you guys enjoyed, and I will catch you guys tomorrow for a new Friday Focus video.